from his studios in New York, it's time for Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora, where sports meets life. Here's your host, Dan Tortora.
Welcome here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. Happy Halloween. This is the Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora Halloween special, and I am more than happy to have you on the broadcast this morning. And we're starting a little bit here after 9, and we thank you so much for tuning in to the show, and thank you for being here, and thank you for being a part of everything. Thank you for all the support over the last 15 years. If you're new to listening to the show, then welcome here for the first time. If you've been listening for 15 years, shout out to you. If you've been listening for the last 2 years, 5 years, whatever it may be, thank you all for your support. You can find Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora 24/7 on WakeUpCallDT.com. You can also find Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on Facebook at WakeUpCallDT, on Twitter at CallDT, and on Instagram at WakeUpCall_DT. So welcome into the show. God bless you, and much appreciation goes out to each and every single one of you. Happy, happy, happy Halloween in this wonderful Halloween special. We have a lot to get into today. We're going to start off with my question to Dino Babers following the 6-2 start and becoming bowl eligible. We'll go on from there to have the Syracuse Stallions on the show, and I'm ecstatic to have the Stallions on the show. You're going to hear in this order from Chris Gilkes, Lloyd Parkmond, and DaJuan Coleman, coming off of the team's first ever game in the history of bringing pro basketball back to Syracuse. You'll hear from these three gentlemen. They won in that game, and they're ranked in the top 25, so you'll hear from each of them in the first hour, and then we'll move on from there to a very special live conversation that we just found out this morning we're going to have with Dave Kline, the CNS Northstars football head coach, as they get ready for their Section 3 championship against West Jenny. You heard from Joe Corley yesterday. You'll hear from Dave Kline today. And then in the second hour of the show, repping the Power 6, you'll hear from every single coach of the American Athletic Conference, including East Carolina, UConn, Tulane, Tulsa, Navy, Memphis, SMU, Temple, USF, Cincinnati, Houston, and UCF. All of the coaches will be on the show today in a very awesome Halloween special. So with that being said, let's hear what Dino had to say to me. You're going to hear my question and his answer following the 6-2 start.
Coach, obviously this is something that takes time. It's not just this season. It's when you first came in, going through 4-8 back-to-back, getting to where you are now. You said there's unfinished business, obviously, but just what you can say about staying the course and seeing where this team is at this point from where you started.
This is all culture. I mean, it starts with academically making sure that they do the things they need to do in the classroom and they get the necessary things that they need to be successful. And our administration does a fabulous job with the tutors and Tommy Powell and John Welhack and giving these young men the things they need to be successful academically. After that, the strength and conditioning program, to be able to play that many plays at that level, at that speed, job that Sean Ettinger and his group does is amazing. Now, I will tell you, I did have words with him because we had two guys go out with hamstrings, and that's a no-no in our program, but that just tells me that they were underhydrated, which means we need to do a better job with hydration. And then to see that senior class lead, you know, how about Eric Dungey being challenged all week? And, you know, he's like Seabiscuit. You know, you don't have to whip him, you just got to show him the whip. You guys got to watch the movie if you know what that means. You don't hit him, just show him the whip and watch him go. And just an amazing, amazing game. But I will tell you this, the whole week of practice, the practice week with DeVito and Dungy was amazing. I've never seen two archers perform at such a high level the entire week with their competition. It was really, really something. The offense this week was, it was absolutely smoking in practice. If it was a racing car, the tires were seen going around the curve. There was noises being made, and people were pushing the envelope. And they did that. They did it that way in practice, and they did it that way in the game.
That coming once again from Dino Babers to start off the show. You just heard from Dino Babers, the head coach of the Syracuse Orange, in his third season with the team, following the 6-2 start to the team. I had an opportunity to speak with him about that, and you heard his direct response to that question that I posed to him about staying the course, believing in it. He came in, there's been some adversity, and now the team is bowl eligible. Staying in Syracuse, the football team is ranked in the top 25. Well, the Syracuse Stallions, after just one game, are also ranked in the top 25. And for the first time ever, I feel honored and privileged to have the team on the show. We've had many times Mike Sugimoto on the broadcast to speak on the team, but now I have the opportunity to talk with the players and the representation on the court of the Syracuse Stallions. We have a trio today with Chris Gilkes, Lloyd Parkmond, and DaJuan Coleman, and we're starting off with Chris live on the line today. Chris, how are we doing?
I'm good. Thank you for having me today, man. How are you doing today?
I'm doing very well, and I appreciate the time. And Chris, I kind of want to go back to the beginning with you and just, what made you want to try out for this team? What made this an opportunity that you wanted to take?
I played college ball, played high school ball, and I just missed that team chemistry, that team atmosphere, doing something I love to do. And when the opportunity came here that they were bringing an ABA team here, I was like, why not go for it? And I went for it and ended up making the team. And now, anything can happen now. So I'm just honored that I was able to make the team and that they were able to bring a team here, because we do have a lot of talent here, and now we get to showcase that.
And when you look at the talent that Syracuse has here, bring me into that first game and just, your takeaways from the game itself, just what you saw from this team. Did you really feel like, I know it's only game one, I know you guys are getting your feet wet in the first ever season, but what did the game feel like? What did the chemistry feel like in that 121-111 win against Oneonta?
The game felt good. Like you said, it was our first game. I had to get a little of the jitters out, get our feet wet a little bit. But I think throughout the game, you saw spurts of us playing really well and showed that the potential that we can really be a great team. And I just can't wait to keep playing, more and more. And, within probably week five, six, we'll be really hitting the fan and rolling. And I can't wait to see that final product, because I feel like we're going to be really good.
And when you look at, the score of this game, you guys took 102 shots in the game. You took 38 three-pointers. I mean, obviously, speaking with Mike Sugimoto, he said, listen, the ABA is about scoring. It's about, seeing those games that are going to get up pretty high. Just what you could say about the amount of shots the team takes, and you guys were just under 50%, just the offensive side of the ABA and how people are not it's not going to be a game where they're going to struggle to see some scoring.
No, it's not. We do have a lot of shooters, a lot of scorers on our team, and probably around the ABA, it is predicated to be, offensively, and they, like it to be entertaining for the fans and stuff like that. I think we have a lot of offensive power, different type of weapons from different type of players, and I feel like we're going to utilize each person's talents to put points on the board. And even though I know it's offensively, we're going to try to, knuckle down on defense so we don't let people score as much as they want on us, but we can still score as much as we want on them, so.
And what can you say about, the defense? I mean, you won the game 121-111. Did you feel like, the team hunkered down at the end of the game? What can you say defensively as you get your feet wet in the season? Was there some nice defensive plays despite the high score? Do you think that, you know, you did shut down Oneonta in certain places when you needed to?
I feel like we still have a couple areas to work on defensively, but like when we needed to get the stops, we did. And we just got to keep that mentality to play defense all the way throughout the four quarters. And I know we will. And once we do that, I feel like our defensive scoring will cut that down as well. We won't let people score as much on us.
What do you love about the opportunity? I mean, when you're playing for the Stallions, you're at Manlius Pebble Hill. I know that we talked about, you know, why you got in the first place, but hindsight being 2020, you got the jersey on, you're on the team now, you played a game. What do you love about this? What could this opportunity bring to you?
I just love being back on the team, you know, being able to go for a goal. You know, our goal is to win this championship, you know, get to St. Louis. You know, even though it's our first year, you know, that's our goal. That's what we're aiming for. And it's just good to be able to, you know, strive for that again, to be able to have fans to play for, community to play for, have people, you know, come support us, have people to want to support us and play good for them. So just having that back in my life and being able to show that and have that feel back in my life is what I really appreciate about this team, you know, and the people I'm playing with, the group I'm playing with, the coaches, you know, we're all unselfish players. We have a good chemistry already. We haven't been together for too long. And I'm just excited about seeing how great we can really be. So that's why, you know, I'm happy that this team came here and I'm happy I'm on it.
And, you know, just with this team being here, some of your teammates, as you gel, as you get closer, what can you say about the makeup of this team, the guys on this team? How would you describe kind of the environment and the players that you have?
I feel like we're unique, you know. We have a good level-headed players. Everyone talented, and everyone have a different ability to their talents. And I feel like we all play together. We're starting to figure out what we all like to do. And once we just keep playing together and get our feet wet more together, I feel like we'll be unstoppable. Like, our talent is really good, and I don't see a problem with us meshing our talent together. It's just going to make us even better.
And then what's kind of like the X factor for you, Chris? Speaking here with Chris Gilkes of the Syracuse Stallions, what makes you special? What makes you a key piece to this team?
My heart. I love playing for my team. I love playing, you know, for the Stallions. I love playing basketball. You know, I'll do anything for any of my teammates. I'm selfish, you know. Intensity, I love bringing that energy. You know, so I feel like, you know, I try to do it all. I try to play defense, offense, pass, you know, everything. I try to be a leader in its own sense as well. You know, I don't try to do too much. I play my role. I let the game come to me. And, you know, I feel like that's what I provide. I don't try to do too much. I just let the game come to me. I play hard every minute I'm on the floor. I don't give up. And, you know, so that's what I would say about myself.
And finally, why should fans come out? Why should they come see this? Pro basketball's back in Syracuse. Why should they make the trip out to see you guys at Manlius Pebble Hill? Or, you know, if you're on the road, because obviously the teams that you're playing up against, teams like Rochester and Scranton and Elmira and Binghamton, not too far away, why should people come out and see you guys play?
Because we're gonna be good. And I feel like we're going to be able to show the fans, we're going to be able to entertain the fans. And I feel like if they came out and supported us, they wouldn't be disappointed. We're trying to, you know, like I said, we're aiming for St. Louis. We're aiming to get to that championship game. And, you know, we won't stop that. No matter what route we got to take, we're going to get there. That's our goal. That's our mission. And I feel like, the fans will appreciate how hard we're going to work and how hard we play each and every game to make sure we achieve that goal. So if they came out, they would see how hard we're working and how much we appreciate them for coming out.
that coming from Chris Gilkes of the Syracuse Stallions. Come out and see them and support them, and they will show you how much they appreciate you by their play on the court and by their treatment of the community. Chris, I know it's the first time you've been on the show, but I thank you so much for being a part of it, and I really look forward to the opportunity of having you back on, and obviously hoping the best as you guys continue forward and continue to make history in Syracuse.
Thank you so much for having me, man. I appreciate you.
All right, man. Happy Halloween. I'll talk with you soon.
Happy Halloween.
All right. Take care. That coming from Chris Gilkes once again. We'll take a step aside here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora in the Halloween special, and we will come back in just a moment with Lloyd Parkmond of the Syracuse Stallions.
This is a Wake Up Call Fast Break.
This is Jimmer Sikowski, owner-operator of Chick-fil-A Cicero, 7916 Brewerton Road in Cicero, right in front of the Home Depot. I had a deep feeling that God wanted me to do something bigger with my life and to help people, help others. He kept putting Chick-fil-A in my life, and I realized as I was going through the franchise selection process that positively impacting the lives of others was really core to what we do here at Chick-fil-A. First of all, it starts with the food. The food is brought in fresh daily. You know, we bring in local produce. We prepare to order in the kitchen. We hand bread our chicken. We hand spin our milkshakes. It's great food. It doesn't taste like fast food. I think the second thing is the way people feel when they come in a Chick-fil-A restaurant. It's different. We try to treat people with intentional kindness here, which is very different and deeper than good customer service. And so, you know, I think it feels remarkable for most people to come in a Chick-fil-A restaurant. And then lastly, the impact that we try to have in the community is very different. It's a big part of the expectation of every operator of a Chick-fil-A restaurant is that they're actively engaged in their community, they're a leader in the community, and they're making a difference. When they realize that what we're striving to do is to shine a little light in their life, that's a very, very different experience than you will have in any other quick service restaurant. And it's that remarkable experience that I think people will emotionally connect with.
I'm George Townsend of Honda City with some good advice when buying a new car. The true cost of owning a new car is determined by the appraised value when you trade it. No vehicle appraises higher than a Honda. Next, look for low APRs and deep discounts. You also want low maintenance costs and great fuel economy. That's why my advice to you is to buy a new Honda. Looking pre-owned, visit our Honda Certified Used Car Center. Honda City, 7140 Henry Clay Boulevard, Liverpool, or HondaCity-CNY.com.
It would be a pity if you don't shop.
Utica Pizza Company spells family. Your family, my family, their family. The recipes that they have shared with each other throughout the years and have now been so gracious to share them with us. I can sit here and talk with you about all the great things that are on the menu. We'd be here forever. So let me say this. Utica Pizza Company is second to none. And now you can bring it home with you and you can dine in the restaurant. UticaPizzaCompany.com will give you all the information that you need. And let me say, these Utica greens, they're the best. Utica Pizza Company. Call them and place your order at 315-214-3060. That's 315-214-3060. Families break bread at Utica Pizza Company.
Welcome back here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. It's an honor and a privilege to be here with you every Monday through Friday. You know when to listen, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Sometimes we go over, that's because we love you, and we want to bring you whatever we can. So, under promise, over deliver. That's what you got to do. Here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora, I thank you for being a part of the community and supporting the local businesses in the community. You can check out who supports Wake Up Call by going to wakeupcalldt.com. One of those businesses is the Syracuse Stallions, supportive of us and partnering with us in their first year, their inaugural season of bringing professional basketball back to the city of Syracuse and central and upstate New York. And it is my honor and my privilege to have representation rendition of that team on the show here with you throughout the months and throughout their first season. Mike Sugimoto has been no stranger to the show. You just heard from Chris Gilkes, and now for the first time ever, I have Lloyd Parkmond on the show to speak with us on his experience in this first game with the Syracuse Stallions. They're ranked in the top 25. They won their inaugural game. Pro basketball is back. We have a lot to discuss, so let's get him on the air. Lloyd, how are we doing today?
Good. How are you doing? Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. And Lloyd, first and foremost, bring me into the opportunity. How did it happen? How did you and the Stallions connect in the first place?
Well, initially, I had saw some posts online for the tryouts on Facebook. And at the time, I was a little weary about it. I spent the previous year and a half not playing, really. And basically just in some men's leagues. And Mike Sugimoto wrote me on Facebook one day, you know, asking how I've been, asking, you know, what I'm up to, and that he'd like if I gave it a shot at tryouts. And I gave it some thought, and I got to it. I got in the gym, and I got back at it, and I went to the first tryout, and I felt good about it. It felt amazing to be back in the basketball shape and back in the routine. And after that first tryout, I signed up for the next two, and that's kind of where it all started.
And so, you know, when he reached out to you, you were kind of leery about it, but he said, hey, come out, give it a chance. What did that mean to you that Mike Sugimoto sought you out and really wanted you to give it a chance, give it a go, just kind of see what you have?
That just showed that he believed in me. That even though I had spent, you know, X amount of time away from the core competitively, that he still had some sort of belief within me and my skills on the court. So that goes a long way with me.
So you go to the tryouts, you get out there, you see how things are going. Bring me into the tryouts. Bring me into, you know, the opportunity that you had in these tryouts and just what it was like. What was the experience like? Was it what you expected? Was it better than you expected? Just bring me into that.
It was definitely what I expected. It was fast paced. It was organized and structured. I was nervous. You know, I hadn't, you know, at the time I wasn't really out there that much, like I said, competitively. But you know, as the tryout went on, I started to get a little bit more relaxed. And we got some drills, did some drills, got warmed up, and then we did quite a bit of scrimmaging, you know, got up and down the floor a lot. And, you know, at that point is when I kind of started to get settled in and get comfortable with the situation. It was a highly competitive tryouts. The whole process was highly competitive. You know, everybody brought their energy and their A game, you know, every day, every play. So it was definitely challenging to get through, to say the least.
Who are some of the guys that are on the team that challenged you the most in these tryouts as you got ready for seeing if you're going to make the team first and foremost, and then getting into the season now? Who are some of the guys that you feel have pushed you?
Two guys really stick out in my head a lot, and that would be Jamel Stanley and Chris Gilkes. Jamel he's a phenomenal athlete, phenomenal player and person. They both are. But Jamel, we play kind of the same position, similar styles, and he's definitely stuck out in the first couple of minutes of me seeing him play. So I definitely wanted to guard him. And then Chris has always been a good player. I've known Chris. I played against him in a couple of leagues around the Syracuse area, and we've had our battles on the court. So you know, it was nothing new. We knew what was going to happen once we, you know, we both got on that court against each other. But it worked out. We definitely pushed each other in a positive way, both verbally and physically on the floor. So,
And when you look at, speaking here with Lloyd Parkmond of the Syracuse Stallions, when you're out there and you're practicing with this team and you're getting ready for the season and it's becoming more and more of a reality, just, you know, as you got closer and closer in this opportunity, you know, became more and more real to you, just, you know, what it meant to you, like you said, because you hadn't been out there, you hadn't really put yourself out there in a while. As you got closer and closer, did it start to feel like, you know, it was second nature? Did it all kind of come back to you? Did it take a little while? What can you say about, you know, reestablishing yourself on the court?
It definitely took a little bit as far as establishing myself within this team after the team had already been made and like practices and all that. I feel like it took a little bit for myself to establish my role and how I play and let the other guys, you know, see how I play and I see how they play. But it's all a process. It's all, you know, a tough process that, you know, we all have to go through, getting adjusted, getting to know each other on the court and off the court. But that process is something we all enjoy, something I enjoy. It's just like another basketball year, just at a different level, higher competition, and it's exciting. All in all, it's exciting to get those nerves back. Just to be back on the floor and to play with a great group of guys, I got my love back. You know, I love basketball so much. It's just like, you know, I had a piece missing for the longest time, and I have that back. And that gives me a ton of energy and will day in and day out to, you know, get better and improve myself.
And speaking here with Lloyd Parkmond, before I let you go, Lloyd, you know, getting back in there, like you said, getting the nerves. You just played your first game. The team won their inaugural game, 121-111 against Oneonta. Bring me into the game and, you know, having those nerves and finally getting back out on the court, just what it felt like, what the game was like, what the atmosphere was like in that first game and getting that win.
Well, the atmosphere was amazing. The fans were amazing. I definitely anticipated there being a good crowd, but they exceeded my expectations, and I'm sure they exceeded a lot of people within the organization, their expectations as well. The crowd was phenomenal. Leading up to the game, I was incredibly nervous. Once I got in the car, I picked one of my teammates up. I picked Jamil up on the way. And once I got with him, for some reason, like, the nerves kind of went away. Then I get around the guys a little bit more pregame, and the nerves really went away. And we had plenty of time to warm up and, you know, get adjusted. And, you know, once the ball went up, you know, I was ready. I was ready to go. You know, everybody on the team has been there and done that in multiple seasons. And I just, at that point, once the ball went up, I felt at ease. I felt good. But I'd be lying if I say once the crowd gets into it and, you know, we make a couple plays and they get all hype and antsy, I get a little nervous as well. But that's just part of the game. That's the beauty of it.
Do you love that, though? I mean, you know, people talk about, you know, they get those jitters, they get this and they get that, and they don't like it. You know, I've always said, you know, as a broadcaster and you know, really as a voice out there in a lot of different ways, not just with sports broadcasting, but with a lot of things that, you know, I go out and I do in my career, is that, you know, they said if you're standing on the side of the stage, you know, whether it's sitting in the studio or being on an actual stage, and you don't get a little bit of that, you know, that fire, you know, you don't get a little bit of that in on your shoulders, a little bit of that feeling, you know, then you're not doing something that you love, that you got to have those nerves. You got to have that feeling because it means you care and it means you love it. Would you say that as well?
Oh, that's very accurate. That's, you know, basketball and many other things. There's a lot of emotion built into it and invested into it. So when those emotions come out, whether it be in the game and the crowds, you know, getting us up, and like I said, when the nerves really start flowing, that's, like I said, that's the beauty of it. That's how you know you truly love what you're doing, and it brings the most out of me. It brings out a different level of play when I get nervous. I don't fold. I soak it all up. Enjoy the moment.
That coming from Lloyd Parkmond. Lloyd, because it's Halloween, I got to ask you about this. Lloyd of the Syracuse Stallions, favorite thing, or what are you doing? What is the Halloween plan? Do you have any plans for Halloween?
I really don't. I don't know why I'm not particularly a Halloween person. I'll be on FaceTime with my daughter for most of the evening. She'll be all dressed up and out there. She actually lives in Florida, but I'll definitely enjoy it that way with her.
Now, do you know what she's going to be for Halloween?
She is dressed up as a fortune teller. Quite the outfit, let me tell you.
Now, was it bought? Was it made? What can you tell us about the outfit?
It was made from her mother's clothing. They spent no money on the outfit. It was all just some makeshift clothing they put together, a little bit of makeup, and nice little headscarf, and you got a fortune teller.
That's awesome. Well, I got to ask you this. So if you're not a big Halloween person, I got to ask you, if you're going to watch any scary movie, anyone at all, which one, you know, could be Halloween related, could be something else. What movie are you watching if you're sitting at home tonight and saying, you know, I got to throw something on? What are you throwing on?
Oh, a scary movie? Ooh, I would have to go with Freddy Krueger. I like Freddy Krueger movies.
All right. So any one of those?
Oh, yeah, anyone. Yeah, Freddy's my man.
And since you're not dressing up, I will ask you this, though. If you could be any superhero, you could dress up as any hero or villain. Well, we'll throw that in there. Any hero or villain in the history of the world, who would you be?
Any hero or... Ooh. I would probably be Superman. I want to fly. That would be amazing. I would definitely fly around and save a bunch of people.
All right, so fair enough. So Lloyd Parkmond as Superman, you could go see him, Superman, on the court, Syracuse Stallions. Go to SyracuseStallions.com, get the info, purchase your tickets, go to the games at Manlius Pebble Hill. And the away games aren't that far, folks. They're playing teams all over upstate New York and the state of New York in general. They'll also be in very close areas in Maryland and Pennsylvania and whatnot. So make sure you go out there and show them some love. They're ranked nationally in the top 25. They won their first game, and they are pro basketball back in Syracuse. Lloyd, I know it's the first time on the show. Had a great time, though, and I'd love to have you back on the broadcast.
Thank you. Anytime. My pleasure.
All right, man. Be good, and have fun with your daughter tonight. I hope that you, at least for her, maybe paint your face or do something. You gotta give it back to her if she's going through all that work today.
Oh, I'll have to paint my nails. Won't be the first time, won't be the last.
Well, have a good time with her, and I'll talk with you soon.
All right, thank you.
Take care. That coming from Lloyd Parkmond once again here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora, and DaJuan Coleman is coming up in just a moment.
This is a Wake Up Call Fast Break.
Carvel DeWitt, it's what happy tastes like. Do you know why? Because we make ice cream. Creamy, rich, flavorful ice cream. Not yogurt or iced milk like some of our competitors. Ice cream. Fresh, by hand, daily. For the calorie conscious, we have something new for you. Our new Carvelite. Same great flavor, creaminess, and texture of our regular ice cream with only 35 calories an ounce. So whether you want an ice cream cake, flying saucer, dasher, carvelanche, hard or soft ice cream, we will satisfy your craving with our fresh, handmade regular or new Carvelite ice cream. Carvel DeWitt.
Welcome back here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. Always an honor and a privilege to be with you throughout the week and in special opportunities that we have, like when we will be hosting a live trivia. Coming back again, Wake Up Call Live Trivia will be every Tuesday downtown at the Press Room Pub, 220 Herald Place in historic Herald Square in downtown Syracuse, and that'll start at 7 p.m. on Tuesdays. And then, of course, a CNY game show night at the Wildcat Sports Pub in Camillus on 3680 Milton Avenue. That happens every last Thursday of each month. And our interviews with West Genesee's teams, CNS's teams, and so much more. We love being out in the community, and I love being on the airwaves Monday through Friday with you. And I love the fact that pro basketball is back in Syracuse. And not only that, but a guy who I wanted to personally and professionally see back on the court, a story that I love, a guy who knows that I've respected him from day zero. This is someone who I appreciate, always love talking to, who has done a lot for my show, always given back to the community, given back to me, and I'm happy that he's back on the court, and that is the man, DaJuan Coleman. Day, how you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good.
Now, DaJuan, we got to start there. You know, the question was, will we ever see DaJuan back on the court again? That question was answered with a yes. What does that moment mean to you, because you spent a couple years at Syracuse coming back from leg injuries. You got back out on the court. The team went to the, you know, you went all the way to the Final Four in 2016. And then ultimately, you know, those injuries nagged you again. Bring me into the get back and all of that stuff that happens behind the scenes to get you back on the court.
For me, I would say the get back was this summer. Well, let me backtrack. Maybe last year when I took my complete year off just to get healthy again. But then all the work really pretty much came in the summertime. When I was playing for the King of Kings, I just felt good. And that's when Mike was recruiting me to play for the Stallions. And we just made it happen, pretty much. My body felt good. My mind was right, and we just made it happen.
Did you, you know, coming back here, I mean, when you finished up at Syracuse, did you feel like this is it, this is over, or did you always feel like you would get another chance?
No, I didn't. You know, I never really had that mindset. I went about it like, you know what, let me take a year off to see how my body felt. So I did that. I took a year off. I felt pretty good. And in the back of my mind, I always wanted to play basketball because that's my first love. So I never really want to give up on basketball. And plus, I was never the person to give up on myself. You know what I mean? So I put my mind to it. I stayed in the weight room. I stayed in shape. I made it happen. That was third time I did this. So I kind of put you where my mindset has always been. You know, I knew it was going to be hard work to get back, and I sacrificed that, and I put in that work, and now I'm back once again, and I'm pretty much ready to play. So everything turned out pretty good so far. So.
All right, and that coming from DaJuan Coleman, and DaJuan, you're coming in a little bit low here. If we could hire it up, so we can hear.
Sorry about that.
Oh no, that's okay. So just to I know you just spoke on the get back and everything, but if you could maybe just take us through that again, so everybody could hear you here on that story.
All right. So last year I decided to take a full year off just to get my body and my mind right. And when I took that year off, I was still in the weight room. You know, I made sure I was still in shape. My mind was sharp. And pretty much, I had a good summer, you know. And this is my third time, you know, coming back from an injury. So, and for me, how I took it is it's all mental. You know what I mean? You got to have a sharp mental when you're going through something like this. And I never was the one to quit on myself. So I knew it was going to be a lot of hard work to get back to where I needed to be. But I wanted to make that sacrifice, and that's what I did. And now I'm back playing again. Like, I pretty much told myself I was going to do. So.
And when you have that, you know, you talk about the mental side of it, you know, that it's such a mental game. You know, you can prepare as much as you want to prepare. You can know your teammates and their tendencies and have good chemistry and know the playbook and know the thing, you know, the plays that you're running and the things that you're doing, and you can lift in the weight room and you can run. But ultimately, if your mind is not working for you and it's working against you, right. So bring me into that. You know, the fact that the mental part of this game is the most important part of the game.
Yeah, the mental part is definitely the most important, because and then going through an injury like how I have, and I did it three times before. Well, this last year was my third time, so I know that you really have to lock in. You really have to lock in, and you really got to focus on what do you want. You know what I mean? I felt like my main focus was just to get back, just to get healthy again, and that's what I thought about every day. Every day I wanted to make myself better, either if it was physical, mental, or spiritual. So I just wanted to make myself better, and I just really locked in. And it's just something you got to have in you. It's not for the weak-minded, but it's something you got to have in you, because a lot of people quit. But I was never really that type of person. You know, I really had to get it. I really – I had –
I pretty much had to put it in work. Whatever I wanted in life, I had to put it in work, because that's just how I was brought up. Nothing was ever given. Everything was earned, so.
And when you look at that, and, you know, like you said, nothing's ever given to you. It was all earned. What did that teach you? How did that help you to, you know, grow as a person, to take care of yourself? I mean, I'm right there with you. I agree with you wholeheartedly that, you know, if you want something, you got to go out and get it yourself. I don't like people that want handouts and, you know, want somebody to do it for them. So bring me into, you know, your life and just being the person that says, if I want this, I have to go do it. I have to prepare for it. I have to get in the lab. Just to speak on that, because I have the utmost respect for that.
And you said, how do that prepare me for life?
Yeah. Just like, how did you get to that point where you realize, you know what, I got to do this. If I want it, I got to go get it myself. And just to speak on how the adversity in your life prepared you for where you are.
Oh, yeah. Just growing up in Syracuse, you know, really growing up, I really didn't have much in Syracuse. So, like, whatever I wanted, like, I had to go get it, or I wasn't going to have it at all, period. And, you know, a lot of people that's growing up in Syracuse, they pretty much understand what I'm talking about. So, just growing up as a kid, you know, I just didn't really have much. And when I say I wanted something, I went and got it. Like, when I told myself I wanted to be a McDonald's All-American, I wanted to play for this, I made it happen, you know? A lot of people talk, but a lot of people don't make it happen. So, and plus, just everything I've been through, it just made me mentally tough. And just growing up in Syracuse just made me mentally tough, too, because, like I said, I mean, nothing here is going to be handed to you. You really got to take every opportunity that's given to you. You really have to take it and make something happen with it. So it pretty much prepared me for life, and I always had that mindset. And my goal is just to stay sharp, just keep going, and that's pretty much it.
When you speak on growing up in Syracuse, you know, some people have different experiences, obviously, of growing up in Syracuse. What can you say about your experience and your challenges of growing up here?
Syracuse is, I feel like it's one of them gritty cities, you know, just because of the weather. You know, it's not really much to do besides Syracuse basketball around here. So a lot of people don't really have that motivation to get up and, you know, go get it every day. But I found my lane, and I worked hard to get where I'm at, and I'm going to keep going, pretty much. But Syracuse is just one of them cities that's just, you either make it or you pretty much don't. You know, I have a lot of friends and stuff that's, you know, that's not here with me today. Either if that's jail or locked up or dead. And you just got to understand, like, when you want something in life, you just have to sacrifice something and you just have to work hard and get it. So.
And speaking here with DaJuan Coleman, and DaJuan, before we wrap up here, just what you can say about that. Like you said, you know, some of your friends are no longer with us, or some of them are locked up. I mean, what did that do to you? What has that done to build you? What has that done to remind you of your mission and what you want in life, to see that, you know, people that you care about and that you love that have been around you have, unfortunately, you know, they're not with us, or they're in situations that are undesirable right now?
Yeah, for me, I just gotta, you know, stay on track and just keep my mind on the end goal and just pretty much do it for them. Like my friend Chi that passed away. You know, I still try to keep his name alive because I wear his number 44 jersey. That's one thing that I'm proud of that pretty much happened to me this weekend when I first stepped on the court, and I'm honoring my friend Rasheed Baker with his number. And just like little stuff like that, I just got to keep their name alive. And I'm not just doing it for me. You know what I mean? I'm doing it for you know, the guys that's not here, the little kids in the inner city that's looking up to me. I'm doing it for the whole city of Syracuse, and I just want to show everybody that, you know, a person like me ain't going to quit. And if I can make it, you could definitely make it, because I've pretty much been through the same circumstances as a lot of kids that's out here right now. And if they could, if I could do it, then they could definitely do it. And that's what I try to preach to the kids when I'm going to go talk to them at these schools every day, and just let them see the bigger picture. So,
and coming from DaJuan Coleman, seeing the bigger picture and doing things the right way and believing in your dreams. And obviously, like you said, you stepped on the court with number 44 for your friend. And just, you know, to be back out on the court, to be back playing, to be back for a third time from injury, and to be representing something that's bigger than yourself with a relationship with your friend, just what that moment felt like for you.
It was great, you know. Like I said, you know, I just been putting in hours, a lot of hours, just to get back to that moment again. And I finally got back to that moment, and I just want to keep it going. I just want to work hard, and I don't want it to be taken away from me again. So whatever I can do to keep it going, that's what I'm going to do. And like I said, just stepping on that court for the first time again in a couple of years, just to play. Got my friend sheet number on. We had a good turnout. A lot of fans came out to see us play. Everything just felt good that night, and we just want to keep it going. This is the first time a pro team is in Syracuse. We just want to take advantage, and whoever's listening out here, if you guys want to come out and show support for this weekend, we greatly appreciate it, and we just want to keep it going.
That coming from DaJuan Coleman. Come out and show support and make your way over to the Syracuse Stallions. Manlius Pebble Hill is where they play. You could also see them locally in upstate New York and around the surrounding areas, even on away games. DaJuan, as always, I appreciate you. We know Syracuse fans travel well, and we know they show out, so make sure you go to these games. Buy your tickets at SyracuseStallions.com. And DaJuan, as always, I appreciate you and respect the heck out of you, so thanks for being here.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
All right, take care. And we now have Coach Kline on the air. We are flipping right over from basketball to football. We have Dave Kline on the broadcast with us, the head coach of the CNS Northstars. They have a Section 3 championship game coming up this Saturday, November 3rd at 6 p.m. inside the Carrier Dome against West Genesee. And it is always my honor and my privilege to speak with Coach. Coach, how are we doing today?
Good, Dan. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing very well, and Coach, just bring me into it. Have there been some yad doggies in practice this week?
Yeah, there's been a couple yad doggies in practice this week. We've been getting after it a little bit.
And, you know, I mean, obviously you are the team that people have circled. You are the team that, you know, the conversation's been about and the expectation has been about. So what has that been like for you now that you've come to this moment, the Section 3 championship? Do you feel like there's a target on the back? Do you feel like that, you know, there's a lot of pressure, or is that all, you know, on the outside looking in and you're not really feeling that? Do you feel the team's feeling it, or do you feel that it's kind of staying at bay right now and you guys are zeroed in?
Well, I think the guys have known all year that we've been kind of in a team that everybody's wanted to play. We've been, you know, we're going to get everybody's best game. The kids have known that all season long, and they've kind of embraced it. But going into this week, the last couple of weeks, our kids have been really relaxed in practice. They've been really dialed in and focused, and they know that everything's about, it's about us and it's about what we do. If we do what we have to do, everything else, you know, we'll take care of business.
And when you look at, you know, doing what you need to do and preparing and being ready, what can you say about what you've seen out of the team this week in practice and just what you've seen throughout the season in practice?
I've just seen, you know, we've gotten better every single week, and, you know, it seems like every day we're getting better. The kids have, you know, communicate really well with each other on the field. They understand what our concepts that we're trying to get across, our game plan. You know, they fully embrace it. They've really bought into watching film on the opponents. So it's been great.
And when you see this team, you see where the team has gotten to. Like you said, you're going to get everybody's best game, undefeated for three straight regular seasons in a row. You've been with the team for four seasons. Just what you could say about the resolve of this team and about not just this year, but the fact that you have a bunch of guys on this team that have won throughout time. They've won throughout history, and they have, you know, tried to create an environment with CNS that is special, something that, you know, obviously is going to be, you know, something that guys in the future can lean on, that this team has really tried to create. Just what you can say about that.
Yeah, I mean, these guys bought in, you know, 4 years ago when I came out there, you know, those, that senior group bought in, but these were the guys, these were sophomores and freshmen at the time, and they bought into everything that we do, everything that we've done, what we preach and believe about being athletes, about competing in other sports, about being good students, trying to be good, being good citizens and doing the right things. They bought into it 100%, and they've actually, you know, they set the bar, they set the tone, you know, and the younger kids look up to them and are trying to follow the same path. So it's been a phenomenal experience for these past 4 years.
What can you say about, you know, going through this and kind of what you've learned as a head coach? I mean, obviously it's not your first go around as a head coach, but what has this team taught you? What has CNS been to you? What has it meant to you over these last 4 years?
It's been, you know, it's been something that's been pretty amazing. You know, I went, you know, actually from being the head coach in Henry going out to CNS, you know, we had some success there, and CNS was a place that hadn't had success. And it just kind of meant that, you know, that the ideas, the thoughts, that the beliefs that we believe in and my coaching staff believes in, that if we can get, you know, everybody believes in, we get everybody together on the same page, it's something that can make a team successful. And, you know, and it's proven that, you know, these kids believed in what we believe in. You know, they listened to us. They followed what we said. And it's been amazing.
That coming from Dave Kline of the CNS North Stars. Dave, you have West Genesee. West Genesee lost one game this season. That game was to you, 27-10. You have not lost a game this season. You are in the Section 3 championship against a team that obviously wants a different outcome this time around. You guys have already seen each other. Just what you could say about the West Genesee program.
Coach Corley's done a phenomenal job out there with those guys. I mean, considering, you know, he held that team together and brought them along from what they've been the last couple of years, and the way they've rebounded this year and getting to the finals, they've been great. They have, you know, two big, tall defensive ends. Their quarterback can throw the ball around pretty well, and the number 17 is one heck of a receiver. You know, and their defense is a very physical defense, so it's going to be an exciting game.
And as you get set for the Dome, just what you can say about the guys. I know that you got a lot of personalities, a lot of energy. What can you say about, you know, getting those guys in the Dome and just what the energy and the culture has been like with the gentlemen that you have on the team?
The guys on my team, they're a great, great group of kids. They're unbelievable. Their personalities, they love football. They love life. They're just really good group of guys that just love being together and playing football. So they're very, very excited, and they can't wait to go play Saturday evening.
That comment from Dave Kline at CNS North Stars. Dave, really quick before I let you go, just what you can say about, you know, maybe some intricate pieces, foundation pieces that you tried to build at CNS that have come through. What are some of the things that just have worked for you that you feel, you know, have helped you get to where you are today? What are some of those things maybe you can, that you tried to instill in the beginning that you can look back at right now?
Well, number one is, you know, my first one out there, I look back, is I made sure I was there all the time. Every day after school, I went out there after work, and I was around the kids, so the kids got to know me, got a feel for me. And then one of my biggest things is I'm not a guy that's going to sit there and preach, play football only, and only do this, only prepare for football. I want the kids to be athletes. I want them to be able to run around. I want them to play other sports. I want them to be kids. That's the other part. I want these kids to be kids and enjoy life. They're teenagers. You only go through it once, so have fun when you're doing it.
And, you know, here's something. Tim Bednarski has a question for you. So the athletics director of CNS has posed a question that he just sent over to me. And he said, ask Dave Kline if he prefers coaching football or track.
let's go with football on that one.
Fair enough. And I mean, somebody that you know lives in both of those worlds though is Jeremiah Willis. Yeah. And just what you can say about Jeremiah and just what he has meant to this team and you know what he has brought, because I know his energy. I feed off of it, you know, as you know, when I'm with him doing a show. Just what you could say about what he's brought to the table.
Jeremiah, just again, like you said, he brings energy. When things are a little slow in practice, sometimes he'll get us, you know, I was looking to say, Jeremiah, we need a little juice, and he gets us going, gets us fired up. So, you know, that's great to have it with him. But he's also a guy that we know, you know, he can, with him and Nate got off our other corners, we can cover anybody in the section, in the area, they can cover him and not worry about the pass. And that if we get the ball in his hands, anytime he touches the ball, there's an opportunity that's going to go to the house, which is an amazing thing, amazing feeling to have.
And let me ask you this question, because we did this recently here just within the last couple weeks, that before you actually went into your game against FM at CNS to get to where you are today, we had a live show at Chick-fil-A Cicero, and I got to realize the personalities. Have the gentlemen put me on the hot seat worse than anybody else? Have you seen them be harder on anybody else than me, or was that a moment in history where you feel that that they truly got somebody? Because I don't know if they could top what they did. I'm sure they'll try, but what did you take away?
No, I thought that they went after you hard. They went after you hard, Dan, and they got you pretty good. We still laugh about Shies all the time, the one with the lady, and you with the on the boat.
Yeah, Shark's got to finish its dinner, Coach Kline. So lastly from me is this morning, obviously I'll be out at the game on Saturday. Why should people come out to the game?
It's just, you know, it's a great high school atmosphere. I mean, it's high school football in the Carrier Dome, great facility, great opportunity for everybody. You know, there'll be a lot of great games, and, you know, it's going to be exciting football, and it's going to be a lot of fun. We can't wait. Come out and enjoy it, because high school football is an amazing thing.
That coming on from the CNS Northstars head football coach, Dave Kline. Dave, as always, I appreciate you. I look forward to seeing you soon, and I look forward to being in the Dome this Saturday.
Thanks, Dan. Appreciate it. You have a good one.
All right, you too. Take care.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye. That coming from Coach Kline, Dave Kline of the CNS Northstars. The CNS Northstars, once again, will take on the West Genesee Wildcats, and that will be happening this Saturday, November 3rd at 6 p.m. inside of the Carrier Dome. If you have not gotten your tickets, make sure that you do so now. Pre-sale is going to get you a couple bucks off, and you can, you know, besides that, you can obviously buy tickets at the door, but make your way over to the Carrier Dome this weekend. No Syracuse football game, but there's still plenty of action happening at the Dome. So make sure you buy your tickets now. Do not wait. Do not hesitate. Get your tickets right now for West Genesee CNS inside of the Carrier Dome happening this Saturday, November 3rd at 6 p.m. I want to thank Joe Corley of West Genesee for all he's done and how he's treated me. And I want to thank CNS Northstars head coach Dave Kline for all that he's done and how he's treated me as well. So just a beautiful thing and a wonderful opportunity that I've had to be around both of these gentlemen and their teams. And I cannot thank them enough for all of the respect that they've given to me, the time that they've given to me, and just the moments that we have had. And I know that this moment this weekend is going to be the most special one we've had up to this point. So thank you to both programs. And thank you, of course, to the ADs. Thank you to the schools. Thank you to the student athletes. And thank you to Chick-fil-A Cicero for hosting CNS. And thank you to Wildcat Sports Pub for hosting West Genesee. And this game this weekend is going to be tremendous. I cannot wait for the opportunity to get out to the Carrier Dome and see these teams. So always looking forward to it, always appreciating it, and the community needs to know that they need to be out there this weekend. So come see Class AA Section 3. Make it happen. West Genesee, CNS, cannot wait. Both of these teams have put me on the hot seat. They are now on the biggest stage. They're on the hot seat, Section 3, and they're going to have a lot of fun. And I can't wait to be inside the Carrier Dome for this tremendous game with two tremendous teams who have obviously seen each other. And, you know, it's just a great story. West Genesee losing one game, and it was to CNS, and lost to nobody else. And then CNS hasn't lost to anybody. And here we are back at this opportunity on this massive stage. I'm really, really looking forward to it. So to all the guys, big thanks. And to everybody who was at Chick-fil-A Cicero with me from CNS, to Connor Hayes and Jeremiah Willis and Shai Broadwater and Jai McGriff, as well as Jordan Seltzer and so on and so forth. Shout out to all you guys because you made it fun and you made it interesting. And Tim Bednarski has been tremendous. I sat down with Jimmer, and when I started my partnership with Chick-fil-A, with Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora and Dan Tortora Broadcast Media, you know, I had said to Jimmer that I'm big on building the community. I was like, you know, I work with West Tennessee with the Wildcat. I'd love to do something here. You know, I can bring that. And he wanted to do that. And we just sat and talked about the idea that CNS is right around the corner, that, you know, he's putting CNS up on the wall, that they already matter to him, that, you know, kids are going to be working there from CNS. And it just created, you know, it just really was created by two people that care a lot. And I want to thank Jimmer Sikowski, the owner and operator of Chick-fil-A Cicero, for being such an amazing partner. And I want to thank Tim Bednarski for the exact same thing. Because, you know, without Tim saying yes, you know, these doors don't open. So I don't know how anybody would say no to an opportunity to spotlight all your programs at your school and spotlight your student athletes and your coaches and build up the community that you love and that you maybe grew up in or at least you live in now. So, you know, it seemed like a no-brainer. It seemed like it made total sense, and to have this opportunity has been tremendous, and I look forward to all the years to come. So thank you, Tim, for all that you do, and thank you to Coach Kline, and thank you to CNS as a whole, and to all the programs and all the young men and women and the coaches and the former players and Pete Moore, the trainer, and everybody over at CNS for all that they've done to really not just give me great shows at Chick-fil-A Cicero and great content, but to also tell their stories, to build up people's lives, and to, you know, above all things that I could take away, that these positive voices and these positive minds have made me a better person and carried me through some tough times that they don't even know they carried me through. So thank you to CNS. We'll take a step aside, and we'll come back in the second hour with the American Athletic Conference coaches in just a moment.
This is a wake-up call, Fast Break.
Clothing that will change with you without you having to change. DreissigLady.com, DreissigLady.com, Lady.com, with the bamboo line relaxed fit clothing as well as the athletic fit clothing. DreissigLady.com is fit for any woman, any time of the day, anywhere. Whatever you're doing, whatever your day commands of you, command yourself to feel comfortable in Dreissig Lady Apparel. Dreissig Lady.com. For all the women out there, feel good in what you're wearing. And don't feel like you have to constantly change throughout the day. Whether you're a stay-at-home mom, a business owner, going for a jog, going for a meeting, or just relaxing at home, DreissigLady.com is the right fit for you. Dreissig Lady.com.
This is Lawrence Papaleo, licensed real estate salesperson for Gilbo Realty. Call our home office at 315-752-9513, or better yet, call or text me directly at 315-748-2524.
Let me ask you a question, Lawrence. If I needed you to help me buy a house, find the right place, could you help me do that?
Joe, I'll help you find your dream home.
You don't ever say my name on the radio, never. If I needed to sell a house, could you help me go about that the right way?
Yes, yes I can.
How do they get a hold of you?
Call me directly at 315-748-2524.
But you also do the commercial property. So if I got a business, couple businesses, got to take one here, move it over there, do this, do that. Are you going to help me buy and sell my commercial property also?
Yes, sir.
I like that. I like that. What's my name again?
I have no idea.
Absolutely. But they need to know your name, so give it one more time.
This is Lawrence Papaleo, licensed real estate salesperson for Gilbo Realty. My phone number is 315-748-2524.
Why don't you tell them your name one more time and that number so we can jot it down?
This is Lawrence Papaleo. Call me or text me directly at 315-748-2524.
Spreading in historic Herald Square about Syracuse's favorite sports and entertainment venue, the Press Room Pub, with lots of room next to 450 parking spots. Wash down their delicious 9-ounce burger for $9.95 with a variety of New York State brewed beers. TVs abound all throughout the location, including their 90-inch monster. Watch your game, enjoy time with family, friends, as well as bringing the kids to the playroom. The SU alumni party for every away football game is making headlines, as well as Robert Drummond, Syracuse football alum, and Dan Tortora's pregame show 2 hours before kickoff for every home game. Private parties available as well for as many as 300 people. Come circulate at the Press Room Pub, downtown Syracuse, and visit PressRoomPub.com right now for more information.
Carvel DeWitt, it's what happy tastes like. Do you know why? Because we make ice cream. Creamy, rich, flavorful ice cream. Not yogurt or iced milk like some of our competitors. Ice cream. Fresh, by hand, daily. For the calorie conscious, we have something new for you. Our new Carvelite. Same great flavor, creaminess, and texture of our regular ice cream with only 35 calories an ounce. So whether you want an ice cream cake, flying saucer, dasher, carvelage, hard or soft ice cream, we will satisfy your craving with our fresh, handmade regular or new Carvelite ice cream. Carvel DeWitt. It's what happy tastes like.
Here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. Always proud to be here with you every Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Eastern Time right here on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. And as I said, WakeUpCallDT.com. In the second hour of the show, I am more than happy to bring to you my conversations with the American Athletic Conference. I had the opportunity collegiately to speak with every single team, and this is for those that listen to the show, you know that this is a normalcy with me, but I had the opportunity to speak with all 12 coaches of the American Athletic Conference, and I am honored to be joined by the entire American Athletic Conference. You're going to hear from everybody today. We're going to start with Scottie Montgomery of East Carolina, then move into Randy Edsall of UConn, Willie Fritz of Tulane, Philip Montgomery of Tulsa, Kenny Amatalolo of Navy, Mike Norvell of Memphis, Sonny Dykes of SMU, Jeff Collins of Temple, Charlie Strong of South Florida, Luke Fickle of Cincinnati, Major Applewhite of Houston, and we'll round it out with Josh Heupel of UCF, Central Florida. So very excited to have that with you right now, and always happy to have you here on the broadcast. So thank you so much for tuning in. And for those of you that maybe don't know the American Athletic Conference that well, or if you know, or maybe you don't have a team inside of the American Athletic Conference, I still implore you to listen to this part of the broadcast. These men are tremendous. They work extremely hard and diligently with their respective programs, and I have nothing but the utmost respect for each and every single one of them. And, you know, it gives you a look around America. It gives you a look around this country, which is always a meaningful thing to hear from all of these different people and, you know, from all these different backgrounds and different places. So the first one is Scottie Montgomery. You're going to hear my questions and his answers on the American Athletic Conference. Here is Scottie Montgomery of East Carolina.
Just to speak on Holton and just what he's done at the quarterback position for you, I know we spoke about him a few weeks back, but now that you've had, like you said, some of that extra time and whatnot, just how he has gelled with the offense and how you've seen him lead up to this point.
Yeah, he's been great. This has been really, really good for him, building a relationship that it takes to be able to captain a football team and really run offensively a football team. You know, it's been really good for him. The biggest thing is that we've been able to bring the offense. I thought, you know, people saw that last week, a couple of weeks ago. We brought the offense a little bit more to him. Now we've been able to open up more stuff that we can do with just 2 weeks of great preparation now on stuff that we can be able to do, whether it be in the red zone, whether it be in the strike zone. He's done a really good job of being able to handle it. He's had a lot of time in the office. He's had a lot of time with coaches. He's had a lot of time to be on the field in the last week or so. So there'll be continued growth from him. But the biggest thing is we're really, really happy with the way that he's been continually building relationships on the team, not only with the offensive players, but the defensive players as well.
And then as far as, you know, being here at your third season with East Carolina, just what you're seeing from the team as a whole, and I know wins, there's been some adversity in the win-loss column, but what are you seeing in year number three? Are things starting to come together behind the scenes? Are there kind of pillars of this foundation that you're trying to build showing up that maybe we're not seeing yet? Like, what can you tell us about building this East Carolina team back up again?
Yeah, definitely. Defensively, we've seen some huge gains. We spent a lot of time, a lot of scholarship numbers on the defensive side of the ball. We've taken a lot of guys, especially in our secondary, in our defensive front, we've taken some guys. So we're really starting to see the benefit of that. Also, you know, the things that people don't know about away from the building, it's just been really clean. Our locker room's a lot better than it has been over the last couple of years. We're a lot stronger together. We're starting to see the benefit on offense, of course, of recruiting because of guys like Holt Naylor's to play more and seeing more of them. But our young guys are now becoming redshirt sophomores and sophomores, so we're seeing a lot of growth. But what we've seen, some of the biggest growth is definitely the guys that we've recruited now are ending up on the field. Some of them are young, but they're starting to make plays. We've had some inconsistency with some of those guys, which you can almost bet on when you're dealing with young people. The addition of this open date and being able to continue to work our fundamentals, I think we'll see a lot of growth here in the next 3 to 4 weeks.
And that is coming once again from East Carolina head coach Scottie Montgomery. Up next is Randy Edsall. Randy Edsall was at Syracuse as the running backs coach of the team back when one of my closest friends, Rob Drummond, was playing running back for Syracuse in the late 80s. And so Randy Edsall now back, in upstates, or I should say in the Northeast, not in upstate, but in the Northeast of the country, back with the UConn Huskies for round two. He was the head coach, then went over to Maryland, and is now back with the UConn Huskies. Here's my conversation with him this week.
Good morning, Coach. How are you?
Good morning. How you doing?
Doing well. Thanks for asking. David Pindell, just what you can say about, I know the team's gone through adversity this season, but how has handled it? I know he's a dual threat for you and has done some good things on film. What are you seeing from him and his leadership at this point despite the adversity?
David's done a really good job for us, and he's done a good job of running our offense and, you know, coming in the first year with Coach Dunn and learning the things that we need to do. You wish you had him, you know, for another year in the system, and but again, he's done the things that we've asked him to do, running the ball, throwing the ball, doing the things that to help make our offense as good as we have been. And again, couldn't be more happy with, you know, how he's gone about, how he's tried to work to improve each and every day. So, you know, he's done a really nice job for us.
And then the team overall, just what you can say, how they've been responding to the adversity this season and maybe some of these close games that don't close out or, you know, go the other way and whatnot. How have you seen the team respond now that you're back at UConn?
Well, they've worked. I mean, we've gotten them to the point where they're, you know, we're practicing better. You know, and again, the thing is, this is a long process here. In terms of where we came in and where, you know, assessing the whole thing, and then we had some, you know, had a change on offense and went to a different system. But the kids have been good, you know, and I've been really impressed with the freshmen because this is all the freshmen know. And they're, you know, it was a group that we, this past class, that we were able to have the time to evaluate, and they fit everything that we're looking for. So I'm excited about them. You know, it's one of those things that, you know, we're kind of like, I take a look at it like we're the minor leagues, you know, and, you know, we got our freshmen. There are a lot of double-A ball players there that we got to make better and get them up to the major league level, you know, and that's what you usually do. You bring them in, you redshirt them, you know, and then you get another year, and then you get really three good years out of them. You know, we don't have that luxury with what we're doing. That's why we have to play so many on defense. And then we got some guys that, you know, have been here that are still maybe in rookie ball or the New York Penn League, that haven't graduated up to even single A, high single A, or double A. So, you know, it's just one of those things, but the effort and the attitude, kids are working, and what we've got to do is just continue to recruit and get better. But really like the freshman class in terms of how they're challenging each other and trying to get better and working to do the things that they need to do, and it's just the process we're going through, and, you know, we're going to do the same things this week and get better and go out to Tulsa and try to give ourselves the best opportunity to win.
That coming from Randy Edsall, once again, of the UConn Huskies here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. You are getting a feel for America, the American Athletic Conference teams all throughout the country, having an opportunity here on the show today, as I had an opportunity to speak with every single coach of the American Athletic Conference, and I feel very honored and privileged for the opportunity to do so. So it's always always a privilege for me to have the opportunity to do this. And to have all the coaches on here, just setting up Willie Fritz for you. So Willie Fritz of Tulane here on the broadcast now. Willie is somebody that he's won everywhere he's been. You know, he's gone through trying to build up the program at Tulane down in New Orleans. It's taken some time, and, you know, but he definitely, when it comes to running the ball and it comes to the offensive line and guys getting to the NFL, that's something that happens down in Tulane. Now they're trying to get more wins on that side of the column than losses, obviously, and build up the program. But as far as the talent that they bring in, the ability that they bring in, and the guy's future in the NFL has been strong. Now it's about that game to game. Here's my conversation with Willie Fritz.
Good afternoon, Coach. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Doing well. Just to at 2-2 in the conference, just what you can say about, you know, what this conference does competitively, how difficult it is to play in week in and week out, and how everybody's going to give you their best game in the AAC.
Great league. You know, I heard Coach Heupel talking about it before I got on, but, you know, very well-coached league, very talented as far as the players are concerned. You know, just for us right now, we're at every game's, you know, going to be a tough one. We're starting to match up a little better, and you know, you also got to do a great job in this league of closing games out. You know, because so many of the games are close. So yeah, great league. I've been very, very impressed with it, and I think it's only getting better.
And then, as far as running the ball, which you've had success with in your time at Tulane, Corey and Darius, Justin at quarterback, even with what he was able to do, 312 yards most recently on the ground. Just what you can say about your backfield and about your weapons, as well as the quarterback position's ability to get involved with the running game as well.
Well, the big thing was we were able to get some movement in up front. And I thought our offensive line played well. Dominic Briggs, who was kind of a homecoming for him, he's from Tulsa, and he was our offensive lineman of the week. And I just thought that was big for us to be able to, you know, get a little bit of vertical push up on the offensive line, and when you do that, you know, with what we're doing and the commitment we have to the run game, you're going to have success.
That coming from Willie Fritz of Tulane here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. We'll take a quick step aside for a fast break. When we come back, you will hear from the rest of the coaches inside of the American Athletic Conference in this Halloween spooktacular special. We've had plenty of people on the show today, and happy Halloween, everybody. Be safe and have fun. Philip Montgomery of Tulsa coming up after the break with Kenny Amatsalolo of Navy, and so much more right here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora.
This is a Wake Up Call fast break.
Gear up with the real deal at Dreissig Apparel, creating what people are going to see and learn about you before they even meet you. Gear up for what you need for your team, business, or event. To look professional, look good, and feel good, outfit yourself at DreissigApparel.com. That's DreissIg Apparel.com. The only place to gear up with the real deal.
What's the universal language of a fan?
clapping your hands. With Fan Hands, the ultimate sports fan accessory, find your team color, slip them on, and start cheering on your favorite team with 11 different colors always in stock on FanHands.com, where you'll find the ultimate sports fan accessory. Real fans wear Fan Hands.
Utica Pizza Company spells family. Your family, my family, their family. The recipes that they have shared with each other throughout the years and have now been so gracious to share them with us. I can sit here and talk with you about all the great things that are on the menu. We'd be here forever. So let me say this. Utica Pizza Company is second to none. And now you can bring it home with you and you can dine in the restaurant. UticaPizzaCompany.com will give you all the information that you need. And let me say, these Utica greens, they're the best. Utica Pizza Company. Call them and place your order at 315-214-3060. That's 315-214-3060. Families break bread at Utica Pizza Company.
Get Hilton quality service at the most affordable price at True by Hilton Camillus, located right next to Costco in Township 5. True by Hilton Camillus offers you their signature sport court where you can enjoy basketball, volleyball, pickleball, soccer, lacrosse, and more year-round in their indoor facility. For reservations and information, call 315-314-8676. That's 315-314-8676. True by Hilton Camillus. Hilton quality service at the most affordable price.
Welcome back here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. Always proud to be here with you every Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Eastern Time right here on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. And as I said, WakeUpCallDT.com. In the second hour of the show, I am more than happy to bring to you my conversations with the American Athletic Conference. I had the opportunity to speak with every single team, and this is for those that listen to the show, you know that this is a normalcy with me, but I had the opportunity to speak with all 12 coaches of the American Athletic Conference, and I am honored to be joined by the entire American Athletic Conference. You're going to hear from everybody today. We're going to start with Scottie Montgomery of East Carolina, then move into Randy Edsall of UConn, Willie Fritz of Tulane, Philip Montgomery of Tulsa, Kenny Amatalolo of Navy, Mike Norvell of Memphis, Sonny Dykes of SMU, Jeff Collins of Temple, Charlie Strong of South Florida, Luke Fickle of Cincinnati, Major Applewhite of Houston, and we'll round it out with Josh Heupel of UCF, Central Florida. So very excited to have that with you right now, and always happy to have you here on the broadcast. So thank you so much for tuning in. And for those of you that maybe don't know the American Athletic Conference that well, or maybe you don't have a team inside of the American Athletic Conference, I still implore you to listen to this part of the broadcast. These men are tremendous. They work extremely hard and diligently with their respective programs, and I have nothing but the utmost respect for each and every single one of them. And, you know, it gives you a look around America. It gives you a look around this country, which is always a meaningful thing to hear from all of these different people and, you know, from all these different backgrounds and different places. So the first one is Scottie Montgomery. You're going to hear my questions and his answers on the American Athletic Conference. Here is Scottie Montgomery of East Carolina.
Just to speak on Holton and just what he's done at the quarterback position for you. I know we spoke about him a few weeks back, but now that you've had, like you said, some of that extra time and whatnot, just how he has gelled with the offense and how you've seen him lead up to this point.
Yeah, he's been great. This has been really, really good for him, building the relationships that it takes to be able to captain a football team and really run offensively a football team. You know, it's been really good for him. The biggest thing is that we've been able to bring the offense. I thought, you know, people saw that last week, a couple of weeks ago. We brought the offense a little bit more to him. Now we've been able to open up more stuff that we can do with just 2 weeks of great preparation now on stuff that we can be able to do, whether it be in the red zone, whether it be in the strike zone. He's done a really good job of being able to handle it. He's had a lot of time in the office. He's had a lot of time with coaches. He's had a lot of time to be on the field in the last week or so. So There'll be continued growth from him, but the biggest thing is we're really, really happy with the way that he's been continually building relationships on the team, not only with the offensive players, but the defensive players as well.
And then as far as, you know, being here at your third season with East Carolina, just what you're seeing from the team as a whole, and I know wins, there's been some adversity in the win-loss column, but what are you seeing in year number three? Are things starting to come together behind the scenes? Are there kind of pillars of this foundation that you're trying to build showing up that maybe we're not seeing yet? Like, what can you tell us about building this East Carolina team back up again?
Yeah, definitely. Defensively, we've seen some huge gains. We spent a lot of time, a lot of scholarship numbers on the defensive side of the ball. We've taken a lot of guys, especially in our secondary, in our defensive front, we've taken some guys. So we're really starting to see the benefit of that. Also, you know, the things that people don't know about away from the building, it's just been really clean. Our locker room's a lot better than it has been over the last couple of years. We're a lot stronger together. We're starting to see the benefit on offense, of course, of recruiting because of guys like Holden Ehlers to play more and seeing more of them. But our young guys are now becoming redshirt sophomores and sophomores, so we're seeing a lot of growth. But what we've seen, some of the biggest growth is definitely the guys that we've recruited now are ending up on the field. Some of them are young, but they're starting to make plays, more plays. We've had some inconsistency with some of those guys, which you can almost bet on when you're dealing with young people. The addition of this open date and being able to continue to work our fundamentals, I think we'll see a lot of growth here in the next 3 to 4 weeks.
And that is coming once again from East Carolina head coach Scottie Montgomery. Up next is Randy Edsall. Randy Edsall was at Syracuse as the running backs coach of the team back when one of my closest friends, Rob Drummond, was playing running back for Syracuse in the late 80s. And so Randy Edsall now back, in upstates, or I should say in the Northeast, not in upstate, but in the Northeast of the country, back with the UConn Huskies for round two. He was the head coach, then went over to Maryland, and is now back with the UConn Huskies. Here's my conversation with him this week.
Good morning, Coach. How are you?
Good morning. How you doing?
Doing well. Thanks for asking. David Pindell, just what you can say about, I know the team's gone through adversity this season, but how has he handled it? I know he's a dual threat for you and has done some good things on film. What are you seeing from him and his leadership at this point despite the adversity?
David's done a really good job for us, and he's done a good job of running our offense and coming in the first year with Coach Dunn and learning the things that we need to do. You wish you had him for another year in the system, and but again, he's done the things that we've asked him to do, running the ball, throwing the ball, doing the things that to help make our offense as good as we have been, and again, couldn't be more happy with how he's gone about, how he's tried to work to improve each and every day. So he's done a really nice job for us.
And then the team overall, just what you can say, how they've been responding to the adversity this season and maybe some of these close games that don't close out or, go the other way and whatnot. How have you seen the team respond now that you're back at UConn?
Well, they've worked. I mean, we've gotten them to the point where they're, we're practicing better. And again, the thing is, this is a long process here. In terms of where we came in and where, assessing the whole thing. And then we had some, had a change on offense and went to a different system. But the kids have been good, and I've been really impressed with the freshmen because this is all the freshmen know. And they're, it was a group that we, this past class, that we were able to have the time to evaluate, and they fit everything that we're looking for. So I'm excited about them. It's one of those things that, we're kind of like, I take a look at it like we're the minor leagues, and, we got our freshmen. There are a lot of double-A ball players there that we got to make better and get them up to the major league level, and that's what you usually do. You bring them in, you redshirt them, and then you get another year, and then you get really three good years out of them. you know, we don't have that luxury with what we're doing. That's why we have to play so many on defense. And then we got some guys that, you know, are, you know, that, you know, have been here that are still maybe in rookie ball or the New York Penn League, that haven't graduated up to even single A, high single A, or double A. So, you know, it's just one of those things, but the effort, the attitude, kids are working, and what we've got to do is just continue to recruit and get better. But really like the freshman class in terms of how they're challenging each other and trying to get better and working to do the things that they need to do, and it's just the process we're going through, and, you know, we're going to do the same things this week and get better and go out to Tulsa and try to give ourselves the best opportunity to win.
That coming from Randy Edsall, once again, of the UConn Huskies here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. You are getting a feel for America, the American Athletic Conference teams all throughout the country, having an opportunity here on the show today, as I had an opportunity to speak with every single coach of the American Athletic Conference, and I feel very honored and privileged for the opportunity to do so. So it's always always a privilege for me to have the opportunity to do this. And to have all the coaches on here, just setting up Willie Fritz for you. So Willie Fritz of Tulane here on the broadcast now. Willie is somebody that he's won everywhere he's been. You know, he's gone through trying to build up the program at Tulane down in New Orleans. It's taken some time, and, you know, but he definitely, when it comes to running the ball and it comes to the offensive line and guys getting to the NFL, that's something that happens down in Tulane. Now they're trying to get more wins on that side of the column and then losses, obviously, and build up the program. But as far as the talent that they bring in, the ability that they bring in, and the guy's future in the NFL has been strong. Now it's about that game to game. Here's my conversation with Willie Fritz.
Good afternoon, Coach. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Doing well. Just to at 2-2 in the conference, just what you can say about, you know, what this conference does competitively, how difficult it is to play in week in and week out, and how everybody's going to give you their best game in the AAC.
Great league. You know, I heard Coach Heupel talking about it before I got on, but, you know, very well-coached league, very talented as far as the players are concerned. You know, just for us right now, we're at every game's you know, going to be a tough one. We started to match up a little better, and you know, you also got to do a great job in this league of closing games out, you know, because so many of the games are close. So yeah, great league. I've been very, very impressed with it, and I think it's only getting better.
And then as far as running the ball, which you've had success with in your time at Tulane, Corey and Darius, Justin at quarterback, even with what he was able to do, 312 yards most recently on the ground. Just what you can say about your backfield and about your weapons, as well as the quarterback position's ability to get involved with the running game as well.
Well, the big thing was we were able to get some movement in up front. And I thought our offensive line played well. Dominic Briggs, who was kind of a homecoming for him, he's from Tulsa, and he was our offensive lineman of the week, and I just thought that was big for us to be able to, you know, get a little bit of vertical push up on the offensive line, and when you do that, you know, with what we're doing and the commitment we have to the run game, you're going to have success.
That coming from Willie Fritz of Tulane here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. We'll take a quick step aside for a fast break. When we come back, you will hear from the rest of the coaches inside of the American Athletic Conference in this Halloween spooktacular special. We've had plenty of people on the show today, and happy Halloween, everybody. Be safe and have fun. Philip Montgomery of Tulsa coming up after the break with Kenny Amatsalolo of Navy, and so much more right here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora.
This is a Wake Up Call Fast Break.
Gear up with the real deal at Dreisig Apparel, creating what people are going to see and learn about you before they even meet you. Gear up for what you need for your team, business, or event. To look professional, look good, and feel good, outfit yourself at drysigapparel.com. That's DreissIg apparel.com. The only place to gear up with the real deal. What's the universal language of a fan? Clapping your hands. With Fan Hands, the ultimate sports fan accessory, find your team color, slip them on, and start cheering on your favorite team with 11 different colors always in stock on FanHands.com, where you'll find the ultimate sports fan accessory. Real fans wear Fan Hands.
Utica Pizza Company spells family. Your family, my family, their family. The recipes that they have shared with each other throughout the years and have now been so gracious to share them with us. I can sit here and talk with you about all the great things that are on the menu. We'd be here forever. So let me say this. Utica Pizza Company is second to none. And now you can bring it home with you and you can dine in the restaurant. UticaPizzaCompany.com will give you all the information that you need. And let me say, these Utica greens, they're the best. Utica Pizza Company. Call them and place your order at 315-214-3060. That's 315-214-3060. Families break bread at Utica Pizza Company.
Get Hilton quality service at the most affordable price at True by Hilton Camillus, located right next to Costco in Township 5. True by Hilton Camillus offers you their signature sport court where you can enjoy basketball, volleyball, pickleball, soccer, lacrosse, and more year-round in their indoor facility. For reservations and information, call 315-314-8676. That's 315-314-8676. True by Hilton Camillus. Hilton quality service at the most affordable price.
Welcome back here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT. Proud to have you here. If anybody's under the weather like I have been for the last 3 weeks, please take care of yourself. Get plenty of rest. That's the thing I haven't done. Drinking plenty of fluids, water, and whatnot. I have done that. So and taking medicine, I have done that. I find that if you have really bad allergies and sinuses, whatnot, that Mucinex seems to work. The Mucinex brand. So if Mucinex ever wants to sponsor and partner with Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora, you would have a very easy selling point because I talk about it all the time and it's the one thing that has worked for me and I hope it continues to work for me and hopefully it works for you. So if you're feeling under the weather at all, that is the road, the route to go that I would push you toward and tell you to obviously do that. With that being said, I'm happy to be here on the broadcast. Just wanted to let you know if I sound a little bit different this week or in the last couple weeks, that is where it came from. So much appreciation and much love for all of you being on the show today. And thank you for being here. Thank you for spending some time on the broadcast. I am always elated and proud to have the coaches of the American Athletic Conference on the show. And today I have the opportunity to share each and every conversation with you. Up next is Philip Montgomery of Tulsa. And this is what he had to say.
Doing well. To look at the season, obviously a lot of adversity that's happened with Tulsa this year, but you played close in a bunch of these games down to one possession. What has been the disconnect? What are you seeing when you go back to the film of being in these games at the end and then just not being able to kind of get over the hump?
Well, a lot of it is just consistency. We got to execute at a better level. We got to be consistent throughout. We have times in the game that we were playing well, and then we just got to be consistent throughout. You know, a lot of that's dealing with young players and at key spots, and we got to continue to grow at those spots and continue to improve.
And then as far as a freshman quarterback, Seth Boomer, who's gotten some time this season, just what you've seen from him and what your takeaways have been from Seth up to this point and moving forward?
Well, I like his demeanor. He's a coach's kid. He's very coachable. I think each week he's showing some signs of getting better and improving, but obviously, has faced some pretty good defenses up to this point in his four starts, and he's just got to continue to grow. You know, with what we do offensively, a lot of it falls on his shoulders, and he's got to continue to make good decisions and be more consistent as we go throughout games. I thought he showed some improvements this week, and he's got to continue that process.
That coming from Philip Montgomery of the Tulsa Golden Hurricane here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. Up next is one of my favorite programs because of the fact of, you know, obviously Kenny Matalolo is somebody who I respect, and I respect the program because Navy and just what Navy means to me, it means to my family. In my studio, I have my grandfather's naval hat, and he was in the Navy in World War II. So is my great uncle Carmen. And I just want to shout them out and send them a lot of love. My family has a connection to the Navy, and my grandfather's hat is with me. When somebody says, what would you take out of a burning building if you could only take one or two things out that are material, what would you take? And I have my grandfather's forklift that he was in his retirement cake because he was also in World War II. He's in the Army, but he worked at Miller Brewing Company, and he drove the forklift. He did a lot of different things, and that was in his cake. And I remember him pulling the toy out of his cake with the frosting on it and handing it to me. And so that's something in my studio. And then my grandfather, my mom's dad, his naval hat that says T.A. Covino on it is here with me as well, and I would take that with me. So the Navy is near and dear to my heart, and so are my grandpas, and I miss them and love them dearly. They passed away when I was 6. I just turned 33, so it's been a while. I want to live a long, healthy, and happy life, and when all is said and done, I can't wait for the opportunity to be able to, you know, see them and hopefully make it to a place where, you know, good people go, and I get to be around my grandfathers again. But hopefully, you know, they always find a way to be with me, and I hope that is no different in the coming history of my life, because I love them dearly and I miss them tremendously. So I look forward to the opportunity of being able to be around them at some point in my life after I'm 100 some odd years old. But you know, they're very special. And I've thought about them pretty much every day since I was 6 years old. So with that being said, and since they passed away, because I thought about them when they were here too. With that being said, Navy, again, close to my heart. Kenny Matalolo, here's what he had to say when we had the opportunity for a Q&A this week.
The team has struggled this year and had some adversity, but just what you could say about Malcolm Perry and what you've seen from him on film and just what he is done for the team, if there's some positive takeaways from his level of play at this point.
Well, he's played exceptionally well the whole year. You know, moving the slot back, he continues to play really well. You know, played well against Notre Dame and, you know, played well against Houston. I mean, the games he's gone in there, I mean, at other positions, he's always done well. You know what I mean? But he adds a different spark to us, a breakaway threat that, you know, we haven't had in a while, but just really proud of Malcolm. He's, you know, done what we've asked. He's moved positions, and he's, every position that he's moved to, he's been committed to it, and he's worked really hard. And, you know, he's, like you said, he's probably one of the bright spots in our team right now. But he's such a selfless kid that I don't think that means much to him, because we're struggling as a football team. And he comes to work every day, and he continues to grind, and hopefully he'll continue to lead, you know, as one of our best teams just from his leadership and his work ethic.
And then as far as, you know, kind of weathering this adversity and navigating through it, just what you could say about, you know, I mean, and you've been in Navy for a long time. You've obviously seen the ups and downs of this team over the last decade plus. What are you seeing this year? What are you taking away as a coach and learning as a coach at this point?
Well, just you know, this is a fragile deal. I mean, just sports, Division I football, but, you know, sports in general, it's a fragile deal. And you just, to win is really, really hard. You know, our games have always been close games in years past. And, you know, we've got to find a way to finish games. And the margin of error is very slim. And for us, a lot of times, there is no margin of error. And so just, you know, continue to stay the course. Continue to keep battling, keep fighting. You know, I was encouraged by the way we played in the second half last week, and unfortunately I was encouraged offensively, and the week before I was encouraged by the way we played in the first half offensively. You know, we got to find a way to put it together. And so, you know, coaching, part of it, the things you learn is, you know, you're in it together. And so if your kids aren't playing well, it's not just the kids' fault, it's your fault too. So as a coach, you got to look at what you're doing. It's continuing to find ways to, you know, schematically help them, find ways to help them psychologically, confidence-wise, try to be and put them in positions to execute. And you just got to continue to press forward, you know, and that's kind of where you're at. But really, this is, and the other cliche in sports, it's really week to week. So every week is hard to win. But then you got to find a way to press forward again, as hard as that is, whether you're winning or losing. You know, you got to find a way to learn from the previous games, take away the positives, try to correct the errors, but then find a way to move forward. And, you know, we haven't been doing too good of that this year, but we still got some goals to be able to hopefully achieve. And, you know, and hopefully we can start off by playing well against a really good Cincinnati team.
That coming from Navy head coach Ken Niumatalolo here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. The next coach up on the docket is Mike Norvell of Memphis. I had this opportunity to speak with Mike Norvell, whose team is 4-4. They started off strong. They could score. You know, offensively, they are there. Defensively, they've struggled to slow teams down and stop teams, which has obviously been an issue to where they are right now. They're looking to get back on the right side of things, and here's my conversation with Mike Norvell of Memphis.
Doing well. Just to speak on, obviously, at 4-4 and 1-3 in the conference, just what you could say about the level of difficulty inside of the AAC, and how, you know, from top to bottom and on any given day, you're going to get everybody's best game and obviously good competition within this conference.
I think it's one of the highlights of our conference is just the overall depth of it. You know, obviously you can see the, you know, there's a couple teams right now playing at an elite level, you know, and their records indicate that. But just throughout this league, it doesn't matter what your record is. I mean, there's teams that are all going to compete at a high level against each other. They're going to compete at a high level, out of conference in games. But this league is one that's continuing to grow. It's one that's got an exceptional number of talented athletes and great coaches. It's definitely a battle each and every week. So you've got to make sure that you perform at a high level, or any team can't beat the other on any given Saturday.
You led one side of the conference last year, and then are going through some adversity right now. Just what you could say that you're taking away as the leader of this Memphis team from last year to this year, and just kind of what you need to do moving forward, what you're seeing on film as the team's trying to navigate through these last 4 weeks.
Yeah, you know, I think our team, you know, it's showcased itself, you know, really well at moments, and then we've had some times where we've come up short, due to lack execution details, you know, the small fundamentals that can cost you in close games. You know, we have 2 1-point losses this year. And in both those games, we lost the turnover margin. We made some critical mistakes down the stretch. And those are things that, as a young football team, you know, we only have 8 seniors we've got to, really focus on the importance of those situations and the specific details to what we're being asked to do within any scheme, or trust in the fundamentals of what we've done throughout the week to be able to perform at a high level. And so, it's been a little bit of a learning process for some of our younger guys. We got to continue to establish the leadership from the older group that we have, but also from the guys that are impactful. There each and every week. We got to make sure that our consistency is to the level that's necessary to be able to win in big games.
that coming from Mike Norvell of the Memphis Tigers here on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. I want to thank the American Athletic Conference teleconference, Chuck Sullivan, and the entire team at the American Athletic Conference for getting these teams on the air with us and giving us the opportunity to ask questions. I take full value of that, and I take the full opportunity to speak with each and every single one of these coaches, and it wouldn't be possible if the American Athletic Conference didn't open the door for that. So thank you to the AAC for the opportunity, and that's why you can hear from all these coaches. I do my research, I do my work, but without an avenue, it wouldn't be possible. So thank you to the American Athletic Conference. Coming up next is Sonny Dykes, who in his first season with SMU started out really dicey, but now the team still has an opportunity to bowl game, and they're doing some good things inside of the American Athletic Conference.
To just look at, you know, the team, and I know you had a close loss against Cincinnati most recently, but starting off the season on the losing side of things and then winning 3 of 4, just what you could say about how you've seen this team kind of come on and then play that close game against Cincinnati, just, you know, what's happened through your eyes of this team in your first season with them, and how, you know, maybe the culture's changing a little bit or evolving a little bit as we go through the season.
Yeah, you know, I've been proud of our improvement. I mean, we, you know, we didn't start well early in the year, and, you know, and then we hit a span where we played a bunch of top 25 teams. You know, we played a TCU team at the time that was in the top 15, then we played a Michigan team that was in the top 15, then we played a Central Florida team that was in the top, you know, 15, and we're getting ready to play a Houston team that's in the top 20. And so, and a Cincinnati team that was just, you know, just in the top 25. So, I mean, I think, you know, that's the thing that we've played some good football teams. You know, I've seen some teams that obviously have had a lot of success and have been good programs and have good players. You know, I think, you know, we've competed at times in those games. You know, I think that it's pretty clear that we've got to build a little more depth in our program, you know, to hang with some of those teams. You know, we played a really good first half against Michigan and a pretty good first half against TCU, but got worn down a little bit in the second half. And you know, so what we have to do is we have to develop the young players that are currently in our program, and then we've got to do a good job of recruiting. And fortunately, you know, we're off to a very good start in recruiting. I'm really excited about the kind of football players that we have an opportunity to recruit here at SMU. And I'm excited about our current players. You know, the buy-in has been really good. I think the buy-in has increased every week. And, you know, I like our team. I mean, I like the kids. They're working hard. They've got a good attitude. You know, we had a really good practice last night. Sometimes when you lose the way that we lost on Saturday, you know, guys will show up and you got to jump start them and all that. And they showed up with a great attitude and the right frame of mind. And so, you know, those things are all positive. You know, but at the end of the day, this is a results business, you know, and we need to figure out how to win some of those games. It's not a, you know, we're not in the moral victory deal or any of that stuff. And so we want to just keep improving and getting better. And I think if you look at our, you know, our schedule this year and our track record, you know, we've played competitive against most of the teams that we played against. And so, you know, Central Florida got a little bit out of hand. Certainly didn't play well against North Texas early, and you got to give them credit. But the rest of the games, you know, we've played pretty well at times and got a little worn down in the second half. So, you know, we just got to keep developing our players, and that's the big thing for us in recruiting. And as I said, I'm optimistic the way all that's going.
Thank you. That coming from Sonny Dykes of SMU. And coming up after the break, we will hear from the rest of the coaches of the American Athletic Conference here inside of Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora. I will have on the broadcast, you will hear from Jeff Collins of Temple, Charlie Strong of South Florida, Luke Fickle of Cincinnati, Major Applewhite of Houston, and Josh Heupel of Central Florida in just a moment here where sports meets life on Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora.
This is a Wake Up Call Fast Break.
Having peace of mind when you're out of town that your furry-loving friend is safe and sound means taking them to Canine Campground, because we all know that when it comes to the love of our pets, it goes well beyond the call of duty to make sure they're safe and sound. Right, Lily? So take a ride to 242 Johnson Street in East Syracuse, New York, and see Canine Campground and where your dog will be staying, in the Classic Cabin, the Executive Cabin, the Grand Cabin, or of course, the Luxury Cabin, because if you know Lily, you know she loves luxury. Now you don't have to wait to the last minute to find a family member or a friend that'll take your dog for a few days. Call Canine Campground at 315-299-4013. That's 315-299-4013. Their drop-off and pick-up times are Monday through Sunday. Check K9Campground.com for more information. That's the letter K, the number 9, and campground spelled with a K.com. K9Campground.com.
When you're going out of town, bring your dog to Canine Campground.
Consistency is, well, consistently hard to find. Unless you head to 119 East 2nd Street in East Syracuse, New York, the home of the Penn and Trophy Center, who has been serving us Central and Upstate New Yorkers, as well as beyond, for decades. The Penn and Trophy Center on 119 East 2nd Street in East Syracuse, New York, gives you an amazing and unique way to customize a memory today. Say it with the Penn and Trophy Center. Be it an Employee of the Month award, a sports award, something for your business, engraving for your family, your loved ones, anniversaries, birthday parties, and so much more, including remembering somebody who served in the military. Say it with the Penn and Trophy Center. 119 East 2nd Street in East Syracuse, New York. The definition of consistency is Penn and Trophy. Browse their products on PennandTrophy.com. That's PennandTrophy.com. And call them for more information at 315-422-8797. That's 315-422-8797. The Wildcat Sports Pub in Camillus, New York is located on 3680 Milton Avenue. In the Home Depot Plaza, it is your family-friendly sports bar and restaurant. Folks, some sports bars aren't family-friendly. Some family-friendly restaurants are not sports bars. The Wildcat Sports Pub in Camillus, New York is proud to be both. It is that marriage that you've been looking for years. The Wildcat Sports Pub is your home base for your sports bar and restaurant needs, games for the kids, indoor and outdoor activities, and enough things on the menu to come back every single week and get to try something new. They're open Sundays from noon to 8 p.m., Monday through Wednesday, 11 a.m. to 11 p.m., and Thursday through Saturday from 11 a.m. to midnight. For reservations and party information, call 315-487-2222 for the Wildcat family-friendly sports pub and restaurant.
Get Hilton quality service at the most affordable price at True by Hilton Camillus, located right next to Costco in Township 5. True by Hilton Camillus offers you their signature tap-it breakfast bar with over 30 different toppings to personalize the most important meal of the day, all complimentary with your stay. For reservations and information, call 315-314-8676. That's 315-314-8676. True by Hilton Camillus. Hilton quality service at the most affordable price.
Welcome back here to Wake Up Call with Dan Tortora on WakeUpCallDT.com, your one-stop sports shop, and on MixLR.com/WakeUpCallDT every Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Proud to be here with you. And on today's broadcast, you're having an opportunity to hear from the American Athletic Conference with teams all throughout the country representing the AAC, a conference that should get a lot more respect than it does. There's a ton of talent within this conference and a lot of great teams within this conference, including the UCF Knights, who have not lost a game last season and have not lost a game this season, and I agree. It seems like America is just hoping that they'll lose so that they don't have to deal with the conversation of them being in the college football playoff, whose rankings came out yesterday. And here's the thing. If a team's undefeated for almost 2 years or for 2 years, then you have to look at the fact that maybe you should just put them in because you gave them Auburn last year as a way to kind of maybe keep them at bay. Auburn was the last team left out of the college football playoff. You know, it was the top four. Auburn was number five. They were the first out, the closest team of getting in, and they gave them to UCF. Like, okay, UCF, you think you're so big and bad? Here, play Auburn. They beat Georgia and they beat Alabama. And then UCF beat Auburn. So, you know, I think that the tests that are being thrown out to UCF, they're taking all these tests and they're acing all these tests, yet nobody wants to let them in. We'll get into that coming up here in the show in just a little bit, and definitely get into it with Josh Heupel, the head coach of UCF. But Temple has played spoiler, and Temple just recently took down a top 25 team. Here's my conversation with their head coach, Jeff Collins of the Temple Owls.
Looking at the way the season's gone, a couple early losses to Nova and Buffalo, and then winning five of the last six. Just what you can say about the team's response to those first couple games, and within season, within the scheme of everything, being able to bounce back and do what they've done up to this point. Just what's impressed you about your team's resiliency and winning five of the last six?
Sure, Dad. Just think that the hashtag Temple Tough that we put on everything is real. We talk about being tough, being physical, being able to respond to adversity and everything that you do in every phase of your life. And those aren't just hashtags. Those aren't just words. That is real and is actual who these young men are in this program and in this organization. And the culture around here is very, very strong. And, the guys just go out and try to go 1-0 every single week, regardless of the adversity, regardless of the situation. The last 2 weeks, we've been down and had to fight, to come back and win the last two games, one of them taking a top 20 team into overtime and getting the win. And I just think it screams to the character that exists in this culture and the young men that I'm blessed to coach on a daily basis that embody everything that Temple University, everything that North Philadelphia is all about. And it's something to be proud of, and it's something to be valued. And, I'm just lucky that I get to coach these guys.
And one of those guys, quarterback Anthony Russo, just what you can say about his level of play, what you've taken away from him up to this point, what you like about how he's leading the offense?
Yeah, I just like the way he's matured over the 2 years that we've been here as a coaching staff, how he's developed into an elite player. And, he's another one that, has had some really good games, but has also had to bounce back in certain games from adversity. And nothing was more so than the fourth quarter against Cincinnati. I have two interceptions. The defense comes out and gets two sudden changes that were huge force, two sudden change stops. And then the last four plays of the game against Cincinnati, he throws two touchdown passes. And, so I just think that speaks to the resiliency of Anthony and the mindset of this team.
That coming from Jeff Collins of the Temple Owls. And coming up next here on the broadcast is my conversation with Charlie Strong. Charlie Strong used to be the head coach of Texas, was also the head coach of not only of Texas, but was the head coach of the Louisville Cardinals at the beginning of the American Athletic Conference before the Louisville Cardinals ultimately moved to the ACC. And now he's back in the AAC with the South Florida Bulls, and he was with them last year, back with them again this year. And here is my conversation with Charlie Strong about his team going into this week inside of the college football ranks. And obviously he's had a lot of success with this team and done a lot of great things with this team and gotten this team to a top 25 ranking and have found the way to come back, found the way to win games and do some special things. He's not finished. The team's got to bounce back from some adversity. They only have one loss this season, and now they're trying to bounce back from that one loss and definitely not getting the credit they deserve. Here's Charlie Strong of the South Florida Bulls.
And obviously the first loss of the season for the team. Just bring me into how they've responded. I know it's been just a couple days, but just what you saw from the team, any hanging of heads, or is this a team that understands kind of what happened and understands the bounce back, just what the environment is like now that they've been hit with a little bit of adversity this season?
Well, I mean, we're sitting there, we're still 7-1, and just you have a bunch of football left in front of you, and you can't let one game beat you twice. So you had a chance to see them yesterday, ran around good, and, you know, they have the day off, so we'll be ready to go back to work on tomorrow. But we just got to get them prepared and have them ready to go play.
And as far as, you know, that game and just what you could say about De'Aaron King and what he was able to do and the type of player that he is, somewhat of a shootout in the game between yourself and Houston, just what you saw from De'Aaron King.
Well, I just think that King is a really outstanding player, and he's kind of reminded me of the quarterback we had last year with Q. He's, you know, he's good enough to beat you with his feet, and he's also good enough to beat you with his arm, and that's what he showed on Saturday. But it's you got to be able to contain a player like that, and we weren't able to do it, and he was able to have the day that he had.
That coming from Charlie Strong of the South Florida Bulls. Up next is Luke Fickle of the Cincinnati Bearcats. The Cincinnati Bearcats in their second season with Luke Fickle are finding a lot of success, have gotten themselves to a good position here right now, obviously with what they've been able to put forward. And just to make a quick note on everything here is to look at the fact that Cincinnati has been ranked in the top 25, and Cincinnati is currently 7-1 overall in the second season under Luke Fickle. And here is my conversation with Luke Fickle about this team, about where the team is at right now, and just what he thinks about the program at this point, with some notes that we're making here. So here is my conversation with Luke Fickle, who is looking to turn the tide of the Cincinnati Bearcats.
Just to speak on special teams a little bit further, just, you know, sometimes feels like a thankless phase of the game. There's always a conversation on the offense and the defense, but special teams has such a big part in so many different intricate places in the game and where the ball's positioned and whatnot. And then obviously in your case, being able to, like you said, tie the game with the kick, and then James Wiggins doing what he did on the interception return. So just what are you, well, in general with defense on that side of it, just what you could say about special teams and then those, you know, plays that are the difference in the game?
Well, I think when you really talk about it, special teams, it's, you know, especially when you're talking about kickers, and special teams in general is, you know, everybody puts an emphasis. How much of an emphasis is really on it? And I think each program's a little bit different, meaning, you know, who do you put your best players on those things? I mean, if you look at our kickoff team, and I'd say there's four, you know, starters that are on our kickoff team. If you look at our punt team, there's, you know, there's at least five or six starters, both offensively and defensively, that are on our punt team. So we put an incredible emphasis on it. But when you look at kickers in general, sometimes it's very unique. I mean, last week, you know, everybody would talk about Cole Smith missing three kicks. And I was, you know, at least positive about, you know, what had happened the week before, not because we missed three kicks, but sometimes you got to look and dive into a little bit more about the way you missed them. And Cole hit the ball really well last week, with the exception, you know, to maybe the one 48-yarder right before halftime where, you know, probably, you know, testing his range a little bit, but the ones he missed were well hit balls that, you know, just, you know, the torsos were a little off, you know, and so you felt good about where you were, you know, where he was, at least hitting the football, and you know, I think then he came out this week and did it when we needed to do it, and not only do it once, not twice, but even on the third time.
And then to my second point, James Wiggins, those plays that come up huge, and this one being in overtime, just what you could say about James, not just on this play, but overall just what you've seen from him, you know, throughout the season on film and his capability, and obviously he's known for it this week, but just what you've seen all the way through.
No, he's been one of those guys that we targeted. I mean, I don't know that he played at all last year, and it was a redshirt freshman, and then through spring football and through the winters and stuff, I mean, we knew he had a lot of ability. He's a guy that, you know, that's very strong in the weight room. I mean, just, you know, a fast guy. I mean, just very athletic in what he's done. And his growth as a football player, you know, through the defense and through Coach Sanuta, is what you're most impressed with. You know, not just his athleticism, his ability, you know, not just to go up and get balls, but to throughout a game kind of understand and, you know, kind of take something that happens early on in the game and be able to react and respond to it a little faster later in the game. And I think that's where you saw what happened, you know, his ability to, you know, some guys tighten up when it gets to be third and two or, you know, third and three and it's an overtime situation and, you know, hey, just let me knock this ball down, you know, so that we can, you know, go to fourth down, you know, or then there's some guys that, you know, they have an opportunity, they kind of look at it the other way and say, how do I go make this, and as opposed to just batting it down. And I think that's where you've seen the growth of James, not just as a football player, but in his confidence to, you know, kind of take that next step and not just make those plays, but anticipate those plays to give him a chance to make some big ones.
That coming from Luke Fickell of the Cincinnati Bearcats. And two final for the show today, hearing from every single coach inside of the American Athletic Conference. Next up is one of the three teams that is undefeated in the American Athletic Conference, and that is the Houston Cougars, who are 4-0 in the conference, 7-1 overall. And that conversation is the one that I had with Major Applewhite, the head coach of the Houston Cougars, and this is what he had to say to me this week when we had the opportunity to speak.
Obviously, with Derek, I know you said a lot of things about him this morning, but Derek, when you saw him kind of going through your workouts and spring ball and through the fall and whatnot, just what you saw in him back then, if you saw the capability and kind of the makings of what he would be at this point, way back when you were just watching him in practice?
Well, you know, the first fall camp in 16, you know, you saw a strong arm, accurate arm, quick release, but you had Greg Ward at quarterback, so this guy's very intelligent, very passionate, great competitor. Where can we play De'Eric? And we had some, you know, issues at wideout and some injuries, and he came in and contributed right away, but I've always felt he has an opportunity to be a tremendous football player just because kind of young man he is and the type of competitor and teammate he is. But started to see some of it this spring. You know, you see some of the new things, and with reps and with continual repetition, you see some of the anticipation increasing, the accuracy, arm strength, quick arm, all those things have always been there, but you just start seeing it fall in line and timing of the plays. And then you see the development, you know, from when those guys work for themselves and do 7-on-7, stuff like that during the summer. You see what work they did in June and July when you go out there your first day of fall camp, and, you know, routes are being hit quicker. Guys are sharper at the top end, so you see what work he did with his wideouts during the summer. And, you know, it's just a testimony to the work that he and his teammates have put in.
And you've had success, obviously, in the conference this year in the AAC. Just what you could say about the talent of the conference and how this conference pushes you throughout the entire AAC season.
Absolutely. I mean, it's November now, and, you know, it's all conference games from here on out. There are no more non-conference games in our side of the league, so it's extremely competitive. There's great coaches. There's exceptional athletes. I mean, you can see that by the way our league's been drafted the last couple of years in terms of, you know, being right up there with some of the other major conferences. So there's great players in this league, great coaches, and there's some difficult spots to go and play on the road as well.
That coming from Major Applewhite of the Houston Cougars. And finally for today's broadcast, UCF and my conversation with Josh Heupel, a team that is undefeated, the only team that won all their games last year and all their games this year so far and continues to win, but continues to not get national respect for it, which I think is ridiculous. I've spoken out against it many times here on the broadcast, and I'll continue to speak about it until something changes in this line of, you know, it doesn't make any sense to me why UCF doesn't get the credit they deserve, but here we go.
For Mac and Milton, just to go a little bit deeper into it, just what you can say about how they push each other, how they made each other better, and how both of them are capable of leading this offense, just what you've taken away from them and their relationship with one another.
They are both capable, obviously. You know, there's some things in week one that D would want to do a little bit differently, but you saw him play with a ton of confidence and poise. A lot of that comes from the work that both of those guys have put in during the offseason, game week preparation, KZ did a great job of just helping him and being a voice on the sideline as well. You know, that's a group that's really tight. They pull for one another. They compete, you know, on the practice field with each other in a really positive way as well. But at the end of the day, whoever's taking snaps, they believe and we believe will give us a chance to go win a football game.
You can only control what you can control, but to see what this team has been able to do at UCF in your first season and overall going back from last season to this season, do you feel that there should be more of a national exposure, more of a national spotlight, more of respect for the conference and the team itself, just kind of what you see from the inside looking out?
Absolutely. This conference deserves a ton of respect for the way it plays during the course of the season, during conference play. But you look at what they've been able to do, you know, this year, but also in years past, just in non-conference play. You know, half the teams in this league were in Power 5 conferences, conferences that got automatic bids to you know, BCS games in the old system. This league, I mean, you have to come ready to play every single week. There's great players. There's great coaching in this league. And, you know, I think at the end of the year, when all the dust really does settle, I believe that this conference is going to get the recognition that it deserves.
That coming from Josh Heupel of UCF, and I hope that he's exactly right on that. I want to thank everybody that was on the show today. Scottie Montgomery, Randy Edsall, Willie Fritz, Philip Montgomery, Kenny Amatololo, Mike Norvell, Sonny Dykes, Jeff Collins, Charlie Strong, Luke Fickle, Major Applewhite, and Josh Heupel, all 12 coaches of the American Athletic Conference football teams. I also want to thank the Syracuse Stallions, Chris Gilkes, Lloyd Parkmond, and DaJuan Coleman for being on the show, and for Mike Sugimoto for all the great work that he does and helped me set that up. I want to thank Dino Babers for answering my question after the game that made the team 6-2 over NC State. So I want to thank him, and of course I want to thank Coach Kline, Dave Kline of CNS. Big time game coming up, CNS West Genesee this weekend, Saturday, November 3rd at the Dome at 6 p.m. Make sure you come out and see the Section 3 Class AA Championship. And on tomorrow's show, we'll talk about college football with Papa Joe. We'll get into basketball with Katie Kalinske and Coach McClass, and we'll get you ready for your fantasy football team and week with the Fantasy Football Power Hour with Mike Sofka of Hall of Fame FantasyFootball.com. God bless. Have a great day. We're proud to be fueled by Monster Energy, and I'll talk with you soon.